My name is Katwana McTyre, President and CEO of the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. COVID-19 has impacted the country in a major way. Everything from social interaction to how we plan events with our families to how we even worship. But where there's tremendous clarity is our mission and what we do, because what we do can't stop. Susan is a 17-year-old female who's been with us multiple times. Here recently, I had an opportunity to speak with her and got to hear from her a bit of excitement, but at the same time, a bit of apprehensiveness in that didn't know what to expect. Will the home be there for her? What gives me hope for Susan is that those conversations can continue. They don't stop once she leaves our residential campus. And we're only able to do that by the staff that we have and by the donors that support that. We've also seen a downtick in donations during this time. We will continue the path. We will continue to serve. That's not gonna change. But we could not do it without that support of the churches and their congregations. And so thank you for allowing that to happen and for maintaining that relationship.
Well, good morning, Satellite Beach United Methodist Church, and happy birthday! Today is the birthday of the church, Pentecost Sunday, the day that Jesus Christ let loose the Holy Spirit on the church, and the church has been active ever since then. Now, I ask you to continue to pray for the church. We're looking at doing a kind of strange outreach project that may or may not involve you. If you were selected, you're probably going to be getting something in the mail this week with the instructions on what we want you to do. We're concentrating on people who live kind of in the church area for this project, but it's going to be an exciting project. So look forward to the mail on that if you live kind of in the Satellite Beach area. And we're still looking for our first service back to be on June 21st. I still need volunteers. I haven't heard from anybody yet because we need people, if we're going to do it, to do a few things. We got a spray to kind of spray down the pews and wipe down the armrest. And then I need a couple of people, one at each door for each services to check temperatures as they're coming in. And if that's something you feel comfortable doing, then please call the church office. But as I said, we're still looking for June 21st, but that could be up in the air. And I'm not expecting everybody to come. In fact, there's some of our people, if you're here, I'm going to yell at you, why are you here? Because you're in an age group and a high-risk group that you shouldn't be here. So we're not expecting everybody to come back. And we want to take baby steps back into this as we move forward. And our prayer focus this week is for those who are living in nursing home or retirement homes, whatever we call them these days. Because a lot of them are lonely. The families can't come in as often or if at all across this land. And so pray for those people because it's got to be very hard on them because they've lost a lot of contact. Well, with that then, let us prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you. Amen. We are truly blessed by Charlotte and kicking us off each Sunday, and thank you so much. And at this then, let us stand for our call to worship.
We sing to the Lord as long as we live.
We will sing to God while we have breath.
God sends forth the Spirit and all is made new.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
Good morning. All hail the power of Jesus' name as we continue worship. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Spirit of the
come now to a time where we lift up our prayer requests and our praises to God. And once again, since we're not gathered here, take this moment as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer to begin by giving Him a word of thanks. So thank Him now for something in your life. So let us pray. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, author of life, creator, sustainer, lover, we come to you this day thanking you for all your goodness. We come to you grateful that you are our God, that you are leading us and you are loving us and guiding us and helping us through these difficult times. And Lord, as we go through these times where we're separated, the connections aren't there as well as they used to be. You are still there connecting us and showing us how we might be connected to one another, and we thank you for that love. And Lord, as we continue to be your church in this community, continue to show us how we might reach out to those in this community. Continue to open the doors, Lord, for ways that we might be of help. We thank you for the doors you have open, Lord. And we thank you for your love and your grace and all the ability you've given us and the resources you've given us so that we can share them with this community and beyond. And gracious Heavenly Father, as we come here this morning praising your name, we pause because we remember there are those among us that are hurting, that need your healing, that are lonely. And so, Lord, we lift up all of those that are in our nursing homes and retirement facilities. Many who haven't seen family in a while except through a window to wave at them. Many probably don't understand what has happened. And so, Lord, we ask your peace be upon all of these families. Give those in those homes comfort. Comfort them in their loneliness. And give them understanding and surround them with love and peace. And be with their families as they're frustrated, Lord, that they can't get there more often. And give them your peace, too. And Lord, we lift up also to you all of those that are on our prayer list and ask that you restore them to the men and women you've created them to be. And Lord, we also lift up to you that one name, that one request that is silent in our heart that we name before you now. And Lord, on this Pentecost Sunday, we do thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit that fills us with power, that helps us to overcome the fear we might have, that helps us to speak to you and to hear your voice, and who gives us purpose and shows us that purpose. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, let us always be in tune to that Spirit, not only as individuals, but collectively as your church, so that we might be your church, be your hands and feet in this community. Send us forth, Lord, to be a reflection of your light in this community. And Lord, we lift up our leaders across this nation, our mayors and governors, and even our elected officials in Washington. Lord, we seem so divided and everyone is making everything political, but you are the one who can break down these barriers and bring us together so that we might work for the good of all. So be with our elected officials, Lord. Send your Holy Spirit to them to open their minds and their eyes. We need good wisdom to them. Send good counsel to them. And once again, Lord, we do thank you for the precious gift of Jesus Christ, who died our death and rose again to offer us eternal life, and who taught us to pray the prayer we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
How wonderful it must have been that Pentecost day.
when the Spirit of God descended. So as we sing, Spirit of God, descend upon my heart, reflect of what he can do in our lives even today.
That time where we prepare to virtually receive our tithes and offerings. And you all have been so generous in keeping our church alive, keeping it active in this community. I thank you for the many who've given special gifts to help the poor in this area. So thank you, and may God bless you as you give to this church. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. O God of grace and peace, God of hope and love, we thank you for all the blessings of this life. We thank you for the gifts and talents, for the purpose in our life and the calling on our life, the ability to enjoy, to laugh, to love, to share. All these things that make life wonderful you give us. And so now, Lord, as we present a portion of that blessing back to you, Lord, use these offerings for your purpose. Guide us in their use. Multiply them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of John, beginning of the 7th chapter, the 37th verse. Hear now these words. On the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scriptures have said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Have you ever been thirsty? I mean so thirsty that nothing else seemed to matter in this world. Nothing mattered in that moment. Well, thanks to the United States Army, I got to experience that kind of thirst once. A thirst that nothing else mattered in the moment. It was in 1979, and I was attending jump school at Fort Benning at the end of July, early August. And Fort Benning, Georgia, in July and early August, is simply hot and humid. It is so hot that during training, they will run you through these showers to soak your clothes so that they will, as it evaporates, it keeps you cool. Well, on that fateful day, it seemed that whenever they would send a group of us to go through the showers and get water, I was always at the cutoff point. I never got to go through the showers or get a drink. I was always moving to the next step of training. And I can tell you, when you tell a drill sergeant you haven't gotten anything to drink and you're thirsty, you do not get a polite answer back. Well, I was making it through the morning, and I think, okay, I am going to make it, because we are now in formation to march back to lunch. And at lunch, I know I can get something to drink. But halfway there, I collapsed and passed out. Well, I got a free helicopter ride at that point to the hospital. And when I got there, the doctor came in to check on me, and he brought in a quart bottle of Gatorade and set it down on the counter. I cannot tell you to this day what he asked me, because all I could do was look at that Gatorade and think how thirsty I am, and I want to drink it. And when he finally, after what seemed like an eternity, he gave it to me, and I downed it in literally a few minutes, and he gave me another bottle, and he comes back in 15 minutes later and says, "Well, don't you have to go to the bathroom?" And I said, "No, I was so depleted of water." But to thirst, water is one of our most fundamental needs to live. When I visited in Israel a few years back, one of the fascinating things I was able to see was to go to see the remnants of a city there that was built in 1500 BC. And one of the things about cities back then is they had the city wall where if they were being invaded, all the residents around the city could come inside and be protected. But one of the problems with most cities is their source of water is outside the city. And for this particular little city, it was located outside, about 400 yards outside the city wall. And so they were able to get water into that city by a very ingenious way. See, when you went in the city wall, you went to this one part in the city, and down about 40 feet, they had dug this huge hole. And down at the bottom of this 40 feet, they had tunneled all the way out past the city gates, all the way to that lake, and tunneled up so that no matter how long a siege may last, they had water coming through that tunnel. Well, as I was there, the water over these 2,500 years has a lot less level, and you could kind of walk through there. And I always wondered when I got to the end of the tunnel and looked to where the lake was and wondered who was the poor individual that said, "Okay, you're to tap through here and the lake will come in." Who got that job and said, "Run fast when you do"? I don't know, but the idea of streams and water are a constant image in the Bible. It is that image of life. And today is Pentecost Sunday, and it is the day we celebrate the birthday of the church, as it is the day that God unleashed the Holy Spirit upon the church. And the living water that Jesus talks about in our passage today is the Holy Spirit. Now, this passage is interesting, that by the way John sets it up. If we went all the way back to the beginning of chapter 7, John tells us that it was the time of the Feast of Tabernacles, the annual celebration where the Jews remembered that the Israelites lived in tents for 40 years during the Exodus from Egypt. And John tells us that the Jewish authorities were looking for Jesus to arrest him and kill him. And that Jesus is asked by some of his brothers, "Are you going to go to the festival?" And he says, "No, the time is not right for me." But he told those who asked him, "You go because the time is right for them." But right after they left, Jesus left. But he goes to Jerusalem secretly. He doesn't make his presence known. He doesn't want to bring attention to himself. And now one of the interesting worship acts performed at the Feast of Tabernacles is the rite of the water libation. On the first morning of Sukkot, a procession of priests goes down to the pool of Siloam to bring to the temple a golden container of water sufficient to last throughout the 7 days of the feast. And the water is brought up with great ceremony. And the shofar is blown, and the pilgrims who had come to Jerusalem for the feast wave their luvas, which are the closed fronds from a date palm tree. And as the priests carry the water around the altar, they're waving these palms. It's the great Hallel. The great Hallel is recited, which is Psalms 113 through 118. And the priest on duty pours out the contents of two silver bowls. One held water and the other held wine. And this was an act of prayer and an expression of dependence upon God to pour out blessings of rain upon the earth. And then on the last or great day of the feast, this is the day that our scripture lesson takes place on, the water libation rite reaches its climax. The priest circles the altar 7 times and then pours out the water with great pomp and ceremony. This was the Hosanna Rabbah, the great Hosanna, which is translated as save now. And as I said, this was the day when Jesus speaks these words we hear in our scripture. It was on this last and greatest day of the feast that Jesus made himself seen by the people. One could imagine that just as this water is being poured out and they're shouting the Hosanna, Jesus stands up and speaks so all can hear. If a man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scriptures have said, streams of living water will flow from within him. One can only imagine the uproar his statement must have caused. The priest had just poured out the water libation as an appeal to the Creator God to provide water for the people. And Jesus, as if to answer the prayer, tells the people to come to him for that water. That water that will be provided to the people. What a radical statement, and what a shocker to the crowds it must have been. And that is what Pentecost Day became. A radical statement to the people of Jerusalem that Jesus Christ is all who he claims to be. The Son of God. It is on that day in history that God let loose the Holy Spirit in us so that we could become filled with streams of living water that will sustain us always and everywhere. And I love that the day of Pentecost would end in the baptism of 3,000 people. The power was so unleashed that people saw it and responded, "Yes, I want to be part of that." J.B. Phillips wrote once that every time we say, "I believe in the Holy Spirit," we mean that we believe that there is a living God able and willing to enter human personality and change it. I believe this is part of what drives the image of Isaiah when he wrote in Isaiah 32, 14 through 20, these words. He writes, "The fortress will be abandoned, the noisy city deserted, citadel and watchtower will become a wasteland forever. The delight of donkeys, a pasture for flocks, till the Spirit is poured upon us from on high. And the desert becomes a fertile field, and the fertile field becomes like a forest. Justice will dwell in the desert, and righteousness live in the fertile field. The fruit of righteousness will be peace, And the effect of righteousness will be quietness and confidence forever. My people will live in peaceful dwelling places, in secure homes, in undisturbed places of rest. Though hail flattens the forest and the city is leveled completely, how blessed you will be, sowing your seeds by every stream and letting your cattle and donkeys range free. What a wonderful image of the transformation that God has for us. And Pentecost is about God giving us the power for these changes to happen. And these changes are happening. And I believe that if we want to truly understand the Holy Spirit in our lives, then we only need to think about the word passion. Passion. Tapping into the power of the Holy Spirit is to tap in to the passion that drives us and sustains us in life. When we look at what it did to the disciples that day, it filled them with power. They no longer hid behind locked doors. They no longer stayed in fear of what humanity would do to them. They spoke boldly and freely with power and purpose. It drove them from their rooms to the streets and beyond. It filled them with passion, with a living stream of water. Someone once noted that, you know, many people like to be good. They even want to be good. But this person said, but really only if they could be good without spending any energy obtaining it. He said, what they really are is they do not like goodness well enough to hunger and thirst after it, or sell all they have that they might buy it. They will not batter at the gate of the kingdom of heaven, but they look with pleasure on this or that aerial castle of righteousness and think, wouldn't it be nice to live there? But most of us don't thirst to live there. But when we give it to the Holy Spirit, when we give our passion over to the Holy Spirit fills us back with God's passion to go and to do for God what we might otherwise be afraid to do. Eric Ritz noticed this in a sermon once. He was talking about Eric Erickson, the great psychologist, who said every person is forced to deal with three crises in his or her life's journey. And these three crises that people have to deal with in their life are first, identity. Who am I? Influence. Whose am I? And integrity. How am I? And Eric Ritz said, you know, as I thought about those, he said, I would add two more critical issues that must be addressed. Inspiration. What is living inside of me and directing my destiny? And intention. What am I thirsting for? See, the closer we are to answering these questions, the closer we are to finding the greatest joy in life. We begin to live for something that drives us, something beyond us, something that gives us joy and purpose. And that ultimate purpose in our lives is the purpose God has for us. And that should be our passion. I think this is why the psalmist writes in Psalm 51, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain in me a willing spirit." The psalmist is asking God to put that passion in us that frees us, that sustains us. Harriet Tubman once wrote, "Every great dream begins with a dreamer. Always remember you have within you the strength, the patience, and the passion to reach for the stars to change the world." See, that's what God gives us through the Holy Spirit. And Nelson Mandela reminds us, there is no passion to be found in playing small, in settling for a life that is less than the one you are capable of living. I think that's the problem with our church too much, is we're living too small. We're afraid to live large. God wants you to live large, to live a life abundant. John records these words of Jesus in John 10, 9 and 11, where Jesus says, "I am the gate. And if anyone enters through me, he will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that you may have life and have it to its fullest, to abundance. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. See, passion is an interesting word when you think about it. One form is the love a couple has for one another in a moment of time. We say they were passionate. There's a deeper meaning of passion. There's a meaning of passion that says when you put more energy into something than is required to do it. It is more than just enthusiasm or excitement. Passion is ambition that is materialized into action to put as much heart, mind, body, and soul into something as it is possible. And see, that's what Christ did. We call his death on the cross the passion of Christ, because Christ put all his heart, mind, body, and soul into making that way of salvation for us. To feel the power of the Holy Spirit, that's what gives us passion. And I think one of the ways that we need to remember how we feel that Holy Spirit is to simply every day take time, sometime in the day, and just sit in God's presence and let the Holy Spirit do that work. Let the Holy Spirit speak for us and speak to us. Let God's love pour over you so that you can become a living stream of water that feeds both you and those around you. As you tap into the stream of the Holy Spirit, know that God loves with great passion and wants you to live the best life possible. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for so many blessings. We thank you for your love, your grace, and your peace. Lord, we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit that fills us, that sends us, that drives out fear, leaving only room for your love. Lord, help us to feel and know that Spirit every day. Well it up in us so that we might live lives for you, that we might live for the purpose you have called us to do, that we might be streams of living water to those around us. We pray this in your Son's most precious holy name. Amen. Amen.
Sweet, sweet Spirit in this place. May we take that Spirit with us out into the world, that Pentecostal Spirit in our hearts.
As we prepare to receive our benediction, reach up and grab God's hand who's standing right next to you. And just take a moment and look at and see his smile. but he's smiling down on you, knowing that wherever you go, he will go with you as long as you hold on to his hand. So go in peace. Go in his power. Go knowing the Holy Spirit will be with you always and everywhere, guiding you, leading you, and loving you. So go and change the world. Amen. Amen.